Okay, it is 3:45, so let's get started. So thank you, everyone. It's been a fantastic day. And my name is Vanessa Thill. I'm an alumna of Barnard College and the exhibits designer at the Milstein. A little about me, I'm a sculptor and writer. I'm involved in community organizing, primarily with a group called Art Against Displacement, which aligns artists to struggle alongside longtime neighbors against gentrification and predatory development. So I'm really excited to have Jazmin, my co-host, and three amazing panelists who are going to share their work today. But I wanted to start with a land acknowledgement. So today, everyone, please just take a moment to just get settled. And I did this morning, but it's a new audience. So just feel your weight being supported and think of the ways that this land has supported life over centuries. So we're situated, many of us, on the island of Manahata in Lenape, Hoboken, the homeland of the Lenape peoples. Due to the violence of colonialism perpetuated by genocide and forced displacement, today the Lenape diaspora is dispersed throughout the US and Canada. As part of this land acknowledgement, I'd also like to acknowledge the stolen indigenous African people whose forced labor built many of the foundations we stand on. Indigenous and Black dispossession, exploitation, and genocide do not exist in a past tense, but neither does the fortitude of those who resist, uphold, and rebuild connections to the land and one another. I would like to point you to the Nanticoke Lenni Lenape tribal nation, who contributed an excerpt of their history to the Undesign exhibit. And you can find the full text of their history via their website that is being dropped in the chat. Thank you, Jazmin. And you can become an official friend of the tribe by donating to support their efforts. So we gather today, not in person, but on Zoom, which is a company worth $100 billion with corporate headquarters in occupying the traditional homeland of the Muwekma Ohlone tribe of the San Francisco Bay Area. If you are calling in from a different area, I encourage you to explore history of where you live at the link nativeland.ca. And I have another important acknowledgement before I turn it over to Jazmin to introduce herself, which goes to the Columbia Student Workers Union, who are currently on strike. They are demanding a fair contract that includes a living wage, better health care, union recognition for all student workers, and protections from sexual harassment. And it's one of the largest student worker unions in the country. And so there are connections between their organizing and the study and the work that we're doing here. They recognize Columbia as a predatory and vastly profitable real estate entity whose actions have negatively impacted students, workers, and our Harlem neighbors in various interrelated and devastating ways. For these reasons, they have recently launched a rent strike. So please check them out, follow them on social media, the Student Workers Union of Columbia. And if you feel inclined to support their strike fund, please do. And with that, I will turn it over to Jazmin.
Thank you, Vanessa. Hello, everyone. My name is Jazmin Maço. I'm a visual artist, researcher, and educator from Long Island, New York, who works with text, images, and natural materials to create stories that highlight histories of displacement, migration, and artistic production throughout the African diaspora. I graduated with a degree from Africana Studies from Barnard College, where I was also a Melanie Mays Fellow and a Barbara Horowitz Scholar of Distinction. I'm currently a postbacc fellow in the Digital Humanities Center at Barnard, and I look forward to moderating this conversation alongside Vanessa. Let's go ahead and introduce the artist for our panel. Vanessa, if you'd like to start off.
Sure. So we have Ayling Zulema Domínguez is a first generation Chicana Dominicana from the Bronx, New York. As a poet, community organizer, and mixed media artist in an abolitionist mindset, her work aims to forge community to affirm belonging, as the first step toward liberation, to imagine new, better, and more radically loving worlds. Her project, Off Limits, a photo essay, uses the visual shorthand of redlining to create portraits of elements, places, and people in communities throughout Harlem and the Bronx that were redlined decades ago. You'll be able to see some of this work today. Her practice involves oral history interviews and everyday abundance. She sees oral tradition alongside photographic documentation as essential in the healing and continuance of our communities and people's lives in the face of deeply entrenched structural racism. And I think maybe I'll post the full bio in the chat in the interest of time. Jazmin, would you like to introduce Chris?
Of course. Christopher López is a photographer and teaching artist who was born in the Bronx in 1984 and then raised between New York and Northern New Jersey. Today, López will present his latest project, A History of Arson, Hoboken, New Jersey, which investigates the misuse of federal funds to disenfranchise the poor. In the case of Hoboken, arson for profit tactics displaced thousands of residents, resulting in the loss of dozens of lives, most of whom were children. Working between the New York area and Puerto Rico, López's artistic practice explores a notion of truth and how it is discerned. By holding the voiced experience of one and putting it in the pool of many, we are afforded the opportunity to delineate a truth, he says. This amalgamation of collected history allows us to then decipher and thus enact the most earnest properties of justice. His work has been exhibited most notably in the major Caribbean art retrospective, Caribbean Crossroads of the World, which included over 100 years of Caribbean art from the region's most prominent artists. As well, his works are currently in the permanent collections of the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery, El Museo del Barrio, and the World Trade Center Memorial Museum. I'll hand it back to Vanessa to introduce our last artist.
Sorry, for some reason I wasn't able to paste it in the chat, but I will figure that out. Ariana Faye Allensworth is our third guest, and she also advised on the Undesigned project over the past year. So we're really honored to bring it full circle. She is a visual artist and researcher based in Brooklyn. Her work builds on interest in photography, spatial justice, and the politics of belonging. She is a founding member of the New York City chapter of the Anti-Eviction Mapping Project, and has participated in the planning of the Undesigned, the Red Line exhibit, as I mentioned, as she's currently developing a new body of work titled Staying Power, a multidisciplinary art and research project that archives a people's history of New York City public housing.
Awesome. Thank you, Vanessa, for those wonderful introductions. At this time, we'll transition to viewing a presentation by each artist to give more context about these projects. Please join me in welcoming Ayling Zulema Domínguez and a presentation of her work, Off Limits, a photo essay.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Vanessa and Jazmin. I'm so glad to be here in this space. Thank you for the land acknowledgement. Let me go ahead and try and share the screen now. All right, does that work for folks? Everyone good? Okay, so as was mentioned, my name is Ayling Zulema Domínguez. I'm from the Bronx, New York. Chicana Dominicana, I'm a poet, mixed media artist, youth arts educator, a bunch of other things. But before I kind of get more into my other works, I really wanted to just delve right into this photo essay and really connect it to the symposium and the undoing of the history and legacy of redlining. So the photo essay itself is what I'd like to call a ground level undoing of the legacy of redlining and the after effects that it has had on the communities in Uptown and South Bronx, New York. I also wanted to provide some guiding principles and key notions to help us kind of understand and process as I go through and to ground the presentation, the project overall. And those are just reclamation, a redistribution of power, belonging, and site activation. So redlining, I won't go too much into the definition since I'm sure those of us attending have a good sense of it, but I did want to highlight the fact that it comes from the practice of drawing a red line on a map. And the folks who would do that in these institutions, in these banks and lending houses, would label them and designate them as off-limits, as hazardous, declining, infiltrated, undesirable, among other terms. As a poet, language is an incredibly powerful tool to me, so I really wanted to bring these words to light and showcase them and kind of keep them in mind as we go along moving forward. Language itself is very world-building, and so in order to kind of redress these legacies, this legacy redlining, these harmful after effects, my goal was to draw from the practice of reclaiming, as so many of our communities and people do when mending and recovering from these traumatic and intergenerational consequences of hundreds of years of racism, to be able to reclaim and kind of take power over something that was meant to belittle or to suppress and oppress is a method of reclaiming power and being able to tap into the power that does exist within these communities and that has simply been put down. So the photo essay itself is a collection of present day kind of mainstay elements. So people, places, things. I included some of them here in the presentation, so you'll see later on, but things such as bodegas, the viejitos playing dominoes on the little green strips in Wash Heights, graffiti, so many different kind of mainstay elements in Uptown and South Bronx, New York, and that are now ironically being displaced as a result of gentrification. And many kind of wealthier, typically white residents coming into these spaces. And that was something that also spoke to me and that I wanted to bring to light in this project is that these were once redlined and deemed as undesirable, as declining, infiltrated areas. And now they are seeing this kind of second wave of infiltration and displacement. And so I wanted to reclaim and give that power to the community to say, this red line around this item that I love is now kind of a marker of being off limits to you who are coming into this space and displacing me after having had to go through all of these consequences of redlining, after having experienced higher levels of poverty and low access to healthy foods, low access to healthcare, et cetera. All of these kind of consequential everyday matters and realities that resulted from redlining. So yeah, that's kind of what that the whole idea was. But as was mentioned, as a poet, as a mixed media artist, what I really try to do is combine the visual, the kind of more tangible, palpable, with the oral storytelling as well. Because oral storytelling is such a cultural tool of power in our communities, and in order to give us more of that liberation, give us more of that importance and a practice in forging these new worlds with our stories, it's so important for me to be able to connect both the visual and the storytelling. And so when I was out there doing these photographs, I was also interviewing community members and engaging us in conversations about abundance, whether it's abundance that we want to envision in the future, in the near future, or it's an abundance that already exists, and what it would be like if they had all the resources in the world that weren't taken away from them by redlining many years ago. So this is just one example of an answer I got from one community member. She was selling tamales, and I asked her what abundance looked like in her everyday life. ¿Cómo es que funciona la abundancia en su vida? And she told me that for her to have abundance in her life, it would mean no tener que levantarme temprano cada día para vender tamales a mi comunidad en vez de prepararlos para mi propia familia y pasar tiempo con mis hijas, which means not having to get up at the crack of dawn every day to sell tamales in the cold to my community, to folks passing by, instead of taking that time and just making them for my own family. She's having to step outside of her home to be able to support herself and her family, rather than having that time to spend with her daughters. And so it speaks again to a lot of the realities that our community members now have to live, as a product of redlining, as a product of these higher levels of poverty in these specific neighborhoods that were redlined and marked off negatively many years ago, and that have still had these consequences. And this was the woman in question. As you see, I went ahead and did the very literal red line practice on these photographs to be able to say these items, these people, these stories, and these hearts need to stay. They're off limits from being displaced, from being moved yet again, from being marked negatively yet again by outsiders. Here are a few other photos. This one is a street altar, is what I like to call it. I don't think they have official names. But if you find yourselves uptown or in the Bronx, you will often see candles and posters and photos and flowers just kind of on these street altars. And this community member was telling me that this person was a victim of gun violence on their street. And it's something, again, that is not inherent to our communities, I feel. It's something that is a product of how we have had to live, how we have had to find a means to live. And it's things that could be redressed very easily if given the right resources. And lastly, is this post I walk by every day up in Wash Heights, and the graffiti marks a fear of a Black planet. And I think that spoke to me very deeply on the notion of suppressing these communities so much and redlining them and finding different iterations of redlining, such as gentrification now, I would even say, to be able to kind of push these communities down more and more, and not allow these communities to build power up. So in order to give power back, I wanted to reclaim this and draw a red line and say, this is off limits. What would a Black planet look like? What would abundance look like in this way? That's off limits. There were a couple of other photos, but again, the notions, the theme was a reclamation of power, of this space, a redistribution of power, not just in kind of this physical taking up of space, but in engaging in these conversations of abundance and reminding our community that we do have abundance and we are capable of this power. It is within us and it shouldn't be taken away, as well as belonging and site activation. And all of these really go together in my mind in the overarching theme that our communities have all of this power within it, within them. It's just really belittled and put down in so many different societal ways. So to do activations and projects like this that build us up even more and remind us of the power that we have and the stories that we have is really important to me. And it's all part of my idea of home as this ongoing project. And it's a really unique one in my opinion, because it is both individual, but also collective. It doesn't operate in a vacuum. And there are so many factors that intertwine and go together, but to be able to address these imbalances of access to safe homes, to feelings of belongingness, there's such an important need to be able to value self-determined narratives, to give a platform to these voices that have been redlined so long ago and that are facing a new wave of displacement, to be able for them to build this community power. It won't take too much longer, but this was my very first kind of photo essay. Most of my other work has taken the form of community art installations in the actual communities that I teach in, that I make art in. Believe in the Poetry is another art project that I've done with youth in the Bronx, first gen BIPOC youth. I worked with them for several months to create poetry on the themes of belonging, of home, of identity, of self-love and abundance, and was able to print out their poems on these posters and place them up in locations that mean something to each of them, and have this QR code that is kind of a map that shows where each of these items is. And I wanted to do that for them to be able to, for them to walk by their poetry every day and say, wow, my words are on this street. I really do belong here. Even if there is displacement, even if there is change and unsettlement in our community, look at my words, look at my story, my everyday life up on this little poster. And so I really wanted to do that in community, and that kind of lends again to my theme of belonging and affirming that, so that these students and this youth can go on to build power in the community. And that was all about me. It's my website up there, my social handles. I am always connecting with folks, always down to bring folks into art projects and to work with my youth as well that I teach very frequently. I teach in South Bronx. So please do reach out with questions, with comments, ideas, suggestions, et cetera. I'm all about living community as a verb. So thank you so much.
Wonderful. Thank you. That was great. Lots of great things to dig into, but I want to just hand it right over for the next presentation, Chris.
Hello, everyone. I'm Chris. I'm a photographer and teaching artist based out of Newark, New Jersey, but I have roots in the South Bronx. Everyone can hear me, right? I see you looking at me, so I said, okay. Excellent work, Aileen. It was so wonderful to hear all of the things that you're doing for your community. Extremely powerful. Congratulations to you. I hope you keep it up. Thank you for having me here on this panel. This is a very important topic, and I appreciate you allowing me to contribute and present my work. Okay, I'm gonna read. I can't speak so freely the way that Aileen did so eloquently. That's horrifying for me. So I'm gonna just read a mission statement that I wrote about my project, which is essentially, you know, a letter I wrote to myself about why I'm doing what I'm doing. So I'll share it with you, and then I'll show my presentation. And that will be that. Okay. My reasons for the production of this the project is the Hoboken Arsons project. And it's a telling of the history of arson for profit tactics that were happening in Hoboken as the city was being gentrified during the late 70s and early 80s. So my reasons for the production of this project derive mainly from my constant interests in understanding the histories of underrepresented and marginalized people. At its core, I would hope that this work can serve as a platform that offers healing and some form of resolve to those people who were affected by the atrocities of gentrification and the arson for profit that plagued the city. Hoboken's arson that occurred during the 70s and early 80s killed 56 people, most of whom were children, and displaced dozens of families. The main goal for this project is to document this history and publish this work as a book. The book would offer a visual arcing narrative that combines traditional portraiture, images of archival objects, symbolic imagery, as well as include written scholarly contributions along with snippets of transcribed oral interviews. It will reveal through evidence the very beginnings of the changing infrastructure through policies enacted by the federal and local governments that ultimately excluded the poor. These rapid changes were what led to the pinnacle moments of violence that brought the insidious tactics of arson as a means to an end, or as the perpetrators would see it, a new beginning. As a storyteller, a visual artist, and a human being, I feel an ethical responsibility to honor the people who lost their lives to these atrocities, to help amplify the voices of those who might feel voiceless, and to educate current and future generations of people of the essentiality of vigilance and accountability towards inequity. My work is not new. It predates me by so many generations of people who have fought tirelessly and selflessly for others. In Hoboken, through community activist organizations such as Por La Gente, and the brave and heroic individuals like Tom Oliveri, who championed tenants' rights and affordable housing in the city. These people sacrificed everything for the posterity and survival of their communities, to ultimately, in the end, see them destroyed. Okay, I'm gonna share my screen and see how this goes. Can we all see this okay?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so that's the end of my presentation. Hello.
Cool. I think I'm up next.
Okay.
I'm gonna share my screen. Can folks see my screen? Yes, awesome. Thanks so much, Chris, for sharing that powerful project. My name is Ariana. I use she, her pronouns. I'm zooming in today from Bed-Stuy, Brooklyn. Thank you so much to Vanessa and Jazmin for the invitation to be in conversation with such a phenomenal crew of folks today. So I wanted to introduce myself using two projects. The first being the Anti-Eviction Mapping Project, which is a volunteer-run collective that I've been a part of for the past many years. Our project seeks to create a counter-narrative around gentrification, displacement, and tenants' rights issues, really all in service of emboldening housing justice movements. And we, as a collective, employ a variety of modalities to advance those goals, including bringing visibility to landscapes of injustice through the mapping of open data about evictions and displacement struggles, also through collecting oral histories and producing storytelling projects with and alongside tenants, and also researching and making information available about folks that are fueling gentrification through real estate speculation and corporate landlordism. The project was founded in the San Francisco Bay Area, which is my hometown, in 2013 during a moment of heightened evictions that were really related to a resurgence of wealth being generated in Silicon Valley that led to increased real estate speculation in Black and Brown communities and historically working class neighborhoods in the Bay Area. And since then, the collective has grown, and we now have chapters in Los Angeles and New York City. I'll introduce our work, just sharing a couple of examples, and then share one more project. But the image that you see here is a screenshot of Nos Cuidamos, which is a collaborative oral history project between the Anti-Eviction Mapping Project and Cities for People, Not for Profit, that began in April 2020, really documenting stories about how residents of Bushwick, Brooklyn organized to meet each other's needs during COVID-19. We conducted oral histories with neighbors and residents and organizers who were participating in mutual aid to understand how their work fits within the larger context of housing organizing and racial justice movements. And we we consolidated all of the interviews into this zine, which can be digitally accessed online, both on the Anti-Eviction Mapping Project site as well as the site of Cities for People, Not for Profit. The other aspects of our work that I feel like are important to lift up, especially in the context of today's conversation, we also employ a lot of methodologies that really work to position renters as experts and center the needs of communities most affected by housing injustice kind of in the digital platforms that we create. So in addition to some of the storytelling work that is exemplified in the Nos Cuidamos project, we also use maps as medium and material to advance housing justice and anti-displacement struggles. So our data visualization maps give form to on-the-ground struggles and provide tools for housing justice organizers to use data as critical leverage points for their organizing. So this image on the left is one of the first maps that was realized by our New York City chapter at Worst Evictors NYC. I can link over to it here. But this was a joint project between the Anti-Eviction Mapping Project and the Right to Counsel NYC Coalition, as well as Just Fix NYC. And this map visualizes all of the court martial evictions in New York City in 2018 and 2019. There were over 18,000. And just to give y'all a sense of the functionality of the map, visitors can filter the map by landlord, even search for their own. It geolocates the sites of the evictions and provides information about that landlord's portfolio and what other properties are connected to their LLC. The map was also used to compile Right to Counsel's worst evictors list, which profiles all of the landlords who evicted the most tenants in New York City in 2019. As many folks may know, many serial evictors often weaponize housing courts to displace tenants, and it's like a very common predatory tactic. And so this data really provided important leverage point for organizers to understand who those key players were. One other map I wanted to speak to as well that's really core to our work is our narratives of displacement resistance map, which you can see here. And this is an interactive map of Bay Area urban displacement. And here you can see the background of the map are these red dots are markers of evictions and displacement between 1997 and present. And these blue dots are connected to long form oral history interviews that were conducted with residents, really shaped by a commitment to channeling the personal and social histories of tenants and recognizing that as powerful as dots on a map can be in visualizing the scale and really insidiousness of evictions. They also can really reduce complex life histories to dots on a map. And it felt important to create opportunities for folks to kind of champion their own representation and provide some humanity behind the dots and lived experiences that were shaping the eviction crisis in the Bay Area. Let's go. Next, I wanted to highlight a current project that is an in progress body of work called Staying Power, which is an art and research project that celebrates a people's history of New York City public housing. I began the project during my time as a Create Change artist in residence with the Laundromat Project and have continued to develop it with the support of Pioneer Works Technology Residency and also Fab NYC's Artist Commission Program. The project really aims to shift local and regional narratives about the New York City public housing community using artistic and storytelling devices like photography, oral history, and community-based archival strategies really to push up against the dominant narrative about public housing and allow new narratives to emerge. The project is both a digital platform and print publication series that presents and maps stories and images of the memories and experiences of folks raised and living in NYCHA. As I'm sure as many folks in this room probably know, ensuring that NYCHA residents can live with dignity and housing security is one of the most urgent housing justice issues facing New York City. New York City's home to the largest public housing authority in the United States. And due to decades of disinvestment really from all levels of government. There's an estimated capital needs deficit of over $32 billion to make necessary repairs to NYCHA's crumbling infrastructure. And in many ways, public housing has become really a national symbol for racialized urban decay. And this narrative of failure has often been exploited by developers and policymakers to justify the downsizing and dismantling of public housing programs throughout the United States. And so much of what the mainstream media writes about public housing really fuels this negative perception and focusing primarily on the conditions of the buildings, mismanagement, and also the impact of concentrated poverty. And so this body of work really aims to respond to the representational gaps in the current narrative about public housing residents and really position residents as archivists and storytellers, and seeks to bridge the distance between the stories that are widely told about NYCHA, between the lived experiences of those raised and living in NYCHA. And so the project website, which you can see a glimpse of here, really functions as a platform for publishing, discussion, and visual presentation about community histories of NYCHA. The images below are from photography workshops with young people, young public housing residents, that create opportunities for them to document how they want their communities to be remembered. Another important dimension of the project is conducting long-form oral history interviews, and really borrowing from a lot of the oral history protocols I gleaned from my work in the mapping project. The website is a repository for interviews and portraits of residents about their life histories. The content on the website will also serve as source material for limited edition booklets and postcards and posters, which have been activated in public space, like the one pictured here from a public activation event I did at Open Streets on Avenue B in the Lower East Side. And the printed matter will also be distributed to folks through the Postal Service as another way of circulating the content of the project. So this project, yeah, really the goal is to highlight public housing as a stabilizing force in urban communities worth fighting for. Really by centering and amplifying the first person narratives of residents. So with that, I will stop sharing my screen so we can dig into conversation. Thank you so much.
Awesome, thank you. Amazing presentations, all of you. And I'm excited to talk more. So the first question that I want to ask pertains to kind of your working methods, and you touched on a little bit the motivations behind your projects, you know, reclaiming history, delineating truth. And I'm curious, I think I want to start with Chris, because we didn't hear too much about your process around how you're working with those images. And so I'd love to hear if we could start with you. What more about your methods?
So really similar work from Ariana and Ayling. Essentially, it's just really just going about it's about going back to the community and hearing first person from the people who have this kind of lived experience. I think that in order for the, you know, it's about education, in order for the public to really understand the scope or the toll it takes on a community, it's really, really important to be able to hear from it, you know, firsthand. And so I do a lot of investigative work. My story, well, the story of gentrification continues. And, you know, it's an ongoing epidemic, you know, it's a problem. And so, you know, I'm digging back 40 years because my interests really lie in kind of like the roots, right, of how people can be so victimized and vulnerable from the very, very beginning. And it really does begin with redlining. When I first learned of the arsons, you know, I immediately went to the idea, what was the city redlined from the very beginning? And so the answer was yes. And I found that it was. And I said, well, that makes sense. They were being red flagged right from the beginning, you know. And so over the course of the ensuing decades, really starting in the 60s and 70s, essentially what the city had done was apply for a federal grant that had made all sorts of promises. And then those promises were ultimately broken, and the money was funneled into private sectors, and that's where the true damage begins. And you know, this idea of profit over people, and it really just victimizes this entire community, leading to violence and leading to people's deaths. So, you know, my work is to be able to just really go back into this community, people that were affected, people that were displaced, people that lost family to these fires, people that can recall standing in front of the immensity of destruction of your community firsthand and see something in a place burn down, see their city burn down and tell their story. What my ultimate goal is, there's several things going on. There's something very personal about all of this. There's something in me that traces back, you know, to my ancestors that makes me do this work. You know, I come from a poor family, and I come from family that, you know, had to deal with identity issues coming to this country from Puerto Rico, having to deal with, you know, being a Black Puerto Rican person in America. And, you know, the thing that really, that I find uneasy, unsettling in my own family history and really the histories of all these people is that what I, a reoccurring thing that I've seen is that people carry around a sense of shame. And that's something that's really interesting to me. I think that they carry a shame with them, and it almost feels like something they may have done was wrong. Or, you know, there's like this guilt or this shame that's carried. And it's like a big part of my work is to abolish this within their own mind and within, you know, within their own understanding of the events, and to say, hey, you know, I've walked into your life so that you can know that, you know, this story doesn't have to be untold, and you can tell me your story and other people can learn from your story, and you're not alone. There's other people out there that were displaced and who lost family and who were estranged from their own families and had their entire lives flipped upside down and had become homeless, just like you. You know, I've met them, I've walked through their doors, and you know, I want to serve as the bridge between all of these lives and create a compendium of this history so that they don't have to be so alone and have this big question mark looming over their heads forever. And then the other thing is to have people who are in these communities now, right, recognize the history of the place that they're living in. And so my real hope is that if you do come across this story, if you do come across my work, that you can somehow inherit some vigilance in your own life of wrongdoing, deception, manipulation of people who have less, and to be vigilant on how they're being victimized or how they're being treated, and so that you can be maybe their advocate. So it's all of that, right? It's a lesson to be learned all the way up into the present. A lot of my work, you know, as much as it is personal to me, it's also about this continual education and this continual learning and this continual voicing of this thing that's painful but real and something to be acknowledged.
That's really great. So many great ideas in there. It's reminding me of a quote from Saidiya Hartman's book, Wayward Lives, Beautiful Experiments. She says, stigma is not an attribute, it's a relationship. I keep coming back to that with, you know, redlining and the kind of, so much of it is mental, right? But I wanna see if Ayling or Ariana want to respond. I know we're touching on a lot of different things, and then Jazmin can ask the next question.
Yeah, I mean, I think similar to what Chris shared, like, I think a lot of the motivations behind my work really stem from like a personal place, a place that's deeply connected to my own family history. And I think a motivation to realizing that, like, as a woman of color, as a Black woman, like, so many of my family members have been like denied access to our history because of like gaps and omissions like in the historic record that then didn't facilitate opportunities for me to fully understand where I came from. And that like a lot of those ruptures were caused by forces of displacement and racism and poverty that like my family was navigating. And so I think a lot of my work really began with trying to reclaim ruptures in my own family archive and their legacy in San Francisco, and trying to make meaning of how they created space and belonging during an era and a time when, if you like look at the historic record, the story about what was going on in San Francisco at that time would suggest that the neighborhoods that they were in were horrible neighborhoods. And if you look at like redlining maps and maps of like urban renewal plans in those communities, it would suggest that those communities weren't the thriving communities that that my family experienced and created context in. I think my work is motivated really by trying to think through how to bring visibility to those stories and stories of communities that have historically been excluded or overlooked from the dominant narrative. And a lot of like to your question about methods, Vanessa, I think a lot of like my work as a result kind of takes cues from participatory action research and critical pedagogy. And I think research traditions that are really rooted in a commitment to affirming the position of those most impacted by injustice as experts and as agents of community memory. And those methods that really like see education as a consciousness raising tool and that really try to like break the monopoly on who gets to be the expert, right? I try to access those and like I'm deeply inspired by practitioners who really engage with those types of modalities in their work.
Fantastic. So we were talking about working methods. Would you want to respond to that, Ayling? We have other questions too.
I can respond super briefly. I mean, I think that's why I was so excited to be in this space, because I resonate so deeply with what a lot of what Chris and Ariana were saying. I think especially for what Chris mentioned about this responsibility and being very cultural and in our lineage, I think for me, something I'm always saying is that artistry and storytelling and creativity is so natural, I think, to a lot of our lineages and our communities, but has been denied over and over because of several societal barriers. And so I think for me, it's very purposeful to be able to go back and really to be able to affirm that to myself, especially because it continues to be hard and continues to be not very encouraged to go through this artistic method of building power in our communities. And so it's always a very intentional alignment, I think, for me to be able to do that in my methods and in my work. I think similarly, just really giving it back to community and uplifting those voices. And I am a culture, so apart from any artwork that I do, I work with United We Dream, which is the largest immigrant rights youth-led organization. And I work as culture change coordinator. And one thing that we're big on is really activating a person's Overton window. I don't know if that's something I learned just this year, but it's this window of kind of changing people's ideas. And so in order to be able to actually change someone's idea through art, which is hopefully, I think what a lot of art artists are trying to do, there's this window that needs to be able to kind of move them. And the only way people can move and actually change those ideas is through these experiential art forms and through actually kind of being touched in these ways through art. So that's something I'm always trying to do.
That's really beautiful. Thank you, Ayling. And to just moving from that, like in your bio, you write, as a poet, community organizer, and mixed media artist, and abolitionist mindset, my work claims to forge community, to affirm belonging as the first step towards liberation, to imagine new, better, and more radically loving worlds. I wanted to pose to Chris and Ariana in the context of this project and also even in your larger careers, what do you believe is the first step towards liberation, and how does your work help you or the communities that you seek to represent to take this first step?
I love this question. It's a big one, and I think I'll answer it from just like, I guess, something that I've been thinking about a lot personally, about realizing that I think so often, like the ways that we get called into community or into movement space is through like a solidarity that's built around our suffering or our marginalization. And that there's like a lot of trauma bonding and like space that happens there. And I think I'm finding ways to remind myself of ways that I can organize and build community from a place of abundance and from a place of like really anchoring in ways that our communities are already thriving and anchoring in like the worlds that we already are building for ourselves. Rather than anchoring just in our suffering or struggle. And I think that in a lot of ways, like, I don't know if it's the first step to liberation, but I think it's an essential component of liberation is like accessing the abundance and inherent wisdom in our communities and not just letting a narrative that we've been told about ourselves or our community to be like the root from which we organize and move.
That's really powerful. And I think it's so, that shift in mindset is so important and integral, I think, to making those next steps. Chris, would you like to respond as well?
This whole process has been, investing myself within this community of people who have, this shared history has been, using the word liberating, it's like I've gotten so much positive feedback from, the people that I've interviewed so far. And it's so often them telling me that it's like the first time that they've ever spoken about this to anyone. And it's just like this huge weight that is just like lifted, and they end up, I've received already several rather emotional responses and emails from them. And that makes me continue because I know that, that's the thing that pushes me forward is that this is the healing that someone out there may need. You know what I mean? And if I need to do that, then I'm going to. And so, people need to speak about these things. People, it's like therapy, man. You need that. You need to talk about that and speak about it as a community and have that weight lifted off of you. Yeah.
That response, Chris, actually leads into another question that I had for all of you about speaking really about potential of the work that you're doing and specifically the words that you're using about the therapeutic potential of the work that you're doing. I'd love to hear about that.
Sorry, Jazmin, who was the question for?
For everyone. Chris,
It just came. Yeah, I spoke about it, yeah.
To hear from everyone.
Yeah. It's a big deal. I don't want to be redundant, but I've spoken with people that they've never even spoken to their wives or their children about these things. It's just something that's really deeply harbored. It might take an artist to walk into your life and say, hey, I'm gonna help you say this thing that's really hard. So, there's tons of healing to be done when people are taking such advantage of, but I think that it's weird because it's like yeah, sometimes it's just talking about it makes them feel better. It really, really does. You could see just the shift, you know, go through a whole hour, 2 hour conversation of these events. And by the end of it, you know, they look kind of joyous talking about tragedy, but they're like, wow, I'd be like, I've never, ever, ever thought about this before in this context, you know, and in this, in such a deep, deep way. So this type of social work is really essential. And, you know, blending it with, you know, this kind of like artistic expression is, you know, it's unique, it's distinct, it's important.
Beautiful. I want to see if the audience has any questions. We're running a little bit up on the hour here. So I just wanted to make sure that we get a chance for that if there are. If not, I don't know. does anyone else want to add anything before we end? Lots to mull over. There's also a great, you know, way to continue with this, you know, learning more about the work of these artists. We're gonna have images from the photo series from Ayling and Chris on view in the lobby of the Milstein with the redlining exhibit that we have here. So definitely check that out. And do you have anything else to add, Jazmin? Oh, you're muted. There you go.
Thank you, guys. I know we're short on time, and this we could spend all day on this conversation. But thank you. Thank you for sharing your work and coming into this space and coming into conversation with all of us. Very excited to have your works up on view in Milstein and to continue to think about these themes and topics. Thank you all to the audience and participants who came to listen in. Vanessa, or I don't know if Mary would like to lead into the next session. We have our keynote coming up next. So thank you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you also very much. It was so wonderful to hear from everyone and share.
Yeah, thanks everyone.
Thank you so much, y'all.
Yeah.
Great. So next we will be leading into our keynote for the evening. We have a break in between so you can stretch your legs and get some food. I don't know, did someone want to introduce with the official blurb?
Sure. Thank you so much, Vanessa, Jazmin, Chris, Ayling, and Ariana. That was wonderful. And we look forward to seeing more of your work. And I look forward to going downstairs and checking it out myself in the exhibition that I'm lucky enough to be in the same building with. This has been a very full day, and I'd like to invite all of our panelists to join us again tomorrow at this link at 11 a.m. But before that, we have a keynote presentation this evening with Peggy Shepherd, who's the co-founder executive director of We Act for Environmental Justice. To access that, you can register for the link if you have not already, or join us at the live stream on YouTube, which will begin at 5:30. So, and we hope to see many of you back with us again tomorrow. We begin at 11 o'clock with Reparations Remedying the Red Line, a presentation by the African American Redress Network. And that is again at this link. The keynote, which begins at 5:30, will be at the links that I posted into the chat. Thank you all for joining us for this day of learning, and we look forward to seeing you all later this evening and then again tomorrow. Thank you.